What's up, guys? Welcome back to Off the Wall Podcast, episode 56, in honor of your NL Cy Young winner, Sandy Alcantara. Just Matt and Kyle today, and we're just going to be chopping it up a little bit about the latest free agency moves, couple signings, throw a trade in there, and then there's some more people available, and of course, all the Carlos Correa nonsense that so he's not a Met. I mean, that's a perfect place to start because I feel like that's probably the biggest news. Carlos Correa is back with the Twins in a very unlikely turn of events. I don't know. I'm glad he's out of the division. I'll say that. Kyle, as a non-biased fan, at least on this front, what do you think about all this?
Oh boy! I mean, at least we finally get some closure in what is most likely the craziest offseason for a single player in MLB history. It was insane, the whole carousel that was going on. Good for Correa, I guess. I mean, he got more than what I thought he was going to end up with. I mean, especially signing those two mega deals with the Giants and the Mets. And then settling for, I believe it was 200 is what he settled for. So with incentives, of course. But yeah, I mean, I didn't expect him to go back to the Twins by any means. But I also think it's good for the game of baseball. I mean, the Twins aren't a huge market team. So, you know, to have a star player like that, it's good for both ends.
Yeah, and I feel like we had talked about this when he initially signed with the Giants, I believe. And I had said that I didn't really feel like the Twins were a candidate signing him to a big contract. I mean, I think there was interest there that they wanted to bring him back, but I felt that they probably weren't going to be willing to spend the money that other franchises were. And I mean, it showed that, but yeah, it kind of feels like the Twins were last resort. Hey, I need somewhere that I know I can get money, and they definitely want to get me back. And I just need to get a couple $100 million and locked up for a couple years. And obviously, that's what he got. But I mean, like you said, good for the Twins. The only thing is, like, how many times were we talking about Carlos Correa last year?
It was a lot.
Not that many. Like, during the season, you were like, what happened to Correa? I mean,
that's true. Yeah. Yeah.
He had a good season, but it was quiet. Like, not compared to what it would have been for the Mets, especially, or even with the Giants, it still would have been a lot bigger, a lot more talked about, I would say. So Overall, I mean, I didn't even know this injury was a issue necessarily.
No, I mean, I didn't either. And as you were saying, like, I don't know if it gave him problems this past season, but I mean, that goes to show you how much he was truly talked about. I mean, especially in the first half of the season, he wasn't even putting up half the numbers that he was normally. I mean, you know, for his sake, he was able to pick it up towards the end and get hot. But yeah, I mean, this really shedded some light on every single person who's a fan of Major League Baseball. I mean, you normally don't hear of, you know, as soon as we get the tweet, I mean, it's done is what we expect. So, I mean, it sheds some light on some of these injuries that these guys suffer and how much it can affect their market.
Yeah, and I don't think two words, pending physical, has ever been so important in any tweet coming from Jeff Passan or any of those high-tier reporters before, because now they have to make sure they include that in any deal, especially Carlos Correa-related, any of the three that have now been signed, or not signed, but reported. So It's just, did the Astros know something that we didn't? Did they know this was up, that they, I don't think they tried that hard to re-sign him necessarily.
No. And I mean, from the tweet that we received earlier today, I mean, the Mets said that he had a good, 3 to 4 years before that ankle starts giving out. That's kind of what, I mean, way to be brutal, Mets front office, but I mean, going back to what you said about the Astros, I mean, as much as it pains me to say, it just makes them look even more like one of the most smarter franchises in baseball.
Yeah, I mean, there's not really any way that you could necessarily predict how it's going to happen because, hey, nobody can predict injuries. But if they knew something like, hey, we got access to all his medicals and we can see that there is a injury here, or like obviously they knew that he had injured it in a game or something like that. Like, hey, we got Jeremy Peña, and I feel like they wouldn't necessarily, like, sure, they knew Jeremy Peña was a good prospect, but like any time that you can retain platinum glove shortstop, debatably the best shortstop in the league, your team is probably going to try pretty hard to do that unless they know something that we didn't. So,
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. I'm glad it wasn't my team involved, that there was no fake Phillies were interested in him, because I mean, I saw the pain that you and Bobby went through with the
Oh boy.
Giants fake signing Aaron Judge. And though that only lasted for what was it, a couple
7 minutes.
minutes yeah, something like that. And while he lasted on the Mets, it was, I think that was reported for like a couple weeks or a week
It
at
was,
least.
yeah.
So, hey, I don't feel bad for Mets fans, but if I did, I feel bad for Giants fans at least,
Oh
but
my God. Yeah, that, I mean, as you were saying, I'm really glad that Judge signed before Correa, or signed before Correa, I should say, because if, I mean, any tweet that I would have gotten about Aaron Judge and whoever in agreement, I would have not believed it until it was truly official, because that pending physical now has a whole lot more meaning than what we initially thought.
yeah, that's it's insane. So,
Yeah.
yeah, we'll move on. We'll keep it in your AL East here. Rafael Devers has
Boy.
gotten the extension he deserves. You got the numbers off the top of your head there, because I know that I do not. It's been over a week now, I think.
I don't have the exact numbers, but I do know it was 300 plus. I believe it was 11 years, and it was the sixth highest major league contract ever signed. Boy, I mean, I didn't expect it, especially from Devers' end. I mean, watching the player who plays next to you for however many years they were together, leaving free agency, seeing this Red Sox front office the way it is at the moment, Bloom did not instill much confidence in his players. And I thought the Red Sox were on board to sign him, but I thought they were going to lowball him, exactly what they did with Xander Bogaerts. But I mean, for both ends to get this done, I think it's, and this is, I'm going to put my Yankee bias aside, but wow, did this save Boston? Because they needed somebody to build around. They're losing guys left and right. They're finally bringing in some more vets, Justin Turner to name one. But this fan base needed it so bad. Watching this team lose Mookie Betts, one of the generational talents we have seen, and now Bogaerts this offseason, it was horrific. And I would not want to imagine how Boston fans are feeling. But for Devers to get this done with Boston, I think it means a lot to the city and a lot to the fan base.
Yeah, for sure. Because like you just said, losing Betts and then Bogaerts, insane. And then if you would have lost Devers too, and if it would have been the same situation where front office lowballed him and he didn't want to re-sign there, I don't know. I wouldn't think it would have got to the point where he would have like demanded a trade or asked for a trade before like the trade deadline. But like, who knows how fractured relations could have gotten. But
Yeah.
thank goodness that didn't happen. Either way, it does make me wonder though why you're more willing to give Devers this big contract. I understand he's a better overall player than Bogaerts, and he's a younger player. And it's you don't want to just let a all-star of the past. I mean, he's been all-star at least once or twice, I'd say. A really good player. You don't want to just let him go for nothing, but like you also want a core to build around. Maybe not. You don't just want one superstar on a team. And if you have the chance to bring back or extend your shortstop, who's like, he put it all out there for the Red Sox all the time. He was career Red Sox, and you didn't try that hard to re-sign him. I don't, that doesn't connect well to me, that why wouldn't you try to re-sign Bogaerts a little bit harder? But I don't know. Maybe I'm not seeing it right. Maybe they're thinking age-wise that it doesn't necessarily match up with their timeline, but I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, this I'm glad you brought that up though, because like I mean, yeah, you did re-sign Devers, which is great for Boston. I'm happy for Red Sox fans. I truly am. They needed it. Yeah, I'm glad it happened for them. But it doesn't like it kind of just didn't make too much sense, because if you're gonna put that amount of money into one player, I mean, you're basically going all in at that point. Why not try to, I mean, and their offer to Bogarts was like, it was laughable. So
Yeah.
it's like, did you really feel that much more like passion towards Devers than you did Bogarts? I mean, you would think it would be both of them, and you would try even harder to sign Bogarts. But I mean, as you said, I guess it wasn't in their timeline for what they wanted. From the outside looking in, it didn't seem like, it really added up. But I mean, I guess you have to take what you get. So, I mean, if you get Devers out of it, gotta be happy some. That's some kind of standard.
Yeah, exactly. It's at least your front office, though they're confusing at times, it clearly they care at least to try and sign back at least the younger good talent, I guess, if that's the excuse. Age is the excuse for not trying to bring back Xander. But I don't know. It like you said, overall, main point, good for the Red Sox, good for their fans, and good for Devers. You got paid,
Oh,
so
he got a massive deal.
yeah. And it's kind of always interesting to me, like the whole way that between Major League Baseball and especially the N or NFL, how every contract has to be bigger than the next. Like it's always interesting to me which guys are like, you know what, I don't really need more. Like I can understand that Rafael Devers, I'm not worth more than Aaron Judge necessarily, or Bryce Harper or Manny Machado, any of those massive contracts that I'm not gonna ruin my relationship with this good franchise just to try to demand the most. And like, it's weird to see that it usually keeps going up, but like, then there's the guys that always fall in line underneath. I don't know. I just find that interesting.
Oh no, it definitely is. I mean, you think of guys like Jose Ramirez, who
Yeah.
truly, I mean, his market is so low for the type of player he is. I mean, me personally, this is me, I think he's a top three third baseman in the league. And you can make an argument that he is the best third baseman in the league, and his contract does not show that whatsoever. And then you
Yeah.
look at a guy like Nolan Arenado, or a guy like, Rafael Devers, who just signed the sixth largest contract in Major League history. I mean, it just sometimes it's, it doesn't fall the way you think it does.
Yeah. Yeah. We want to move on to something else now. Trade. Little
Yeah,
trade.
let's do a quick trade. I mean, I guess we can go with the first one, and I'll let you open this one up, because this pertains to your Phillies.
Phillies, I like this. I like this move. The Phillies get reliever Gregory Soto, left-handed reliever, and Cody Clemens, pitcher, I believe, right? Cody Clemens.
I honestly don't know.
I feel like he's a pitcher just because his dad, I believe, is Roger Clemens, but I could be
That's
wrong.
about all I know about Cody Clemens, is that he is Roger Clemens' son.
Yes, okay. Cody Clemens. Oh no, he's a hitter. Third base, first base, and second baseman. I mean, there's not too much to see there. That was kind of just we need something back in return for what the Phillies were giving him. But the Phillies gave up Matt Vierling,
Nick Maton,
Nick Maton.
and my personal I have a personal connection to Donnie Sands, catcher. He was with the
Oh, that's
Yankees
right.
minor league system.
Yeah. So to me, Phillies won this trade. Gregory Soto, he's a good reliever. He's been an all-star the last 2 years. I know every team has to have an all-star, but still, he's probably borderline all-star caliber otherwise. Top 10, I think, in the league in saves, something like that. Top 15 around there. I don't know if he's going to be slotted in at Philly as the closing role. I don't know, but he's going to fit in well in the bullpen. And I hate to depart with Matt Vierling. He's the main, I would say, the main point of the trade. Obviously,
Mostly,
like
yeah,
you said,
definitely.
Donnie Sands, a good prospect, but overall, Vierling is probably the main point, and like he's a good player. I don't see great potential there, but he's a good, solid everyday outfielder. So overall, win for the Phillies, in my opinion. Glad they're bolstering up their bullpen even more. What do you think?
So for me, I have a lot of connections to the Phillies. My brother's a diehard Phillies fan, and I live close to their double A minor team. So for me, I am, up to date on the Phillies. And for me, my first initial reaction was I do think the Phillies won this trade. The only thing that worries me is how much versatility that the Phillies gave up. I mean, and a lot of their bench too. Matt Vierling was a perfect bench piece. Obviously, Nick Maton as well. Donnie Sands was kind of the throw-in. I didn't expect him to contribute too much at the major league level, but I do think, obviously, as you said, the Phillies are getting a stud in the bullpen, and pairing him with Jose Alvarado and Sir Anthony Dominguez, I think that's a three-headed monster. And if you can get any type of old production out of Craig Kimbrell, your guys' bullpen is looking pretty good. You have Bilotti in there. I believe Sam Coonrod is still with you guys. Maybe.
Yeah, I think
He's in
so.
there somewhere.
Shaky situation, I think, but
But yeah, I feel like that bullpen is really bolstering, and that was one of my worries with Philly, especially last year. I did not know how their bullpen was going to hold up, but it proved me wrong in the playoffs, and I feel like they're just, I mean, Dombrowski's going all in on that bullpen, and I love it. I think it's great for the Phillies. But like I said, if I had to nitpick a little bit, I don't like how much versatility that they gave up.
yeah, I think that's fair. Like you said, that's a half their bench there basically. And for a closing pitcher, you can always debate the value of a closing pitcher compared to an every about everyday value player, because somebody's playing every day, closer or reliever per se. You might not see every day, he might not pitch every day, but those are the important innings when he can come in and lock down an inning and close a game out. So in my opinion, like you said, Phillies won the trade. Does suck giving up a couple bench pieces, but sometimes it feels like bats like that are easy to pick up or call up sometimes. But like you said, relievers, glad the Phillies are bolstering it up, because it wasn't great. It wasn't awful, but it wasn't great last year. In the playoffs, it really seemed to really shore up somehow. Not sure how, but I was impressed in the postseason. But 2 years ago in the regular season, it was terrible. So we've come a long way. Now, Craig Kimbrell, I don't know that I expect a lot out of him, especially seeing what he did in Los Angeles last year. Still had a lot of saves, but he had a lot of heartbreakers for the Dodgers. So I don't have high expectations there, so that when he lets us down, I hopefully won't be too disappointed. But overall, I like the move for the Phillies. On the Tigers end, I don't know.
It's the Tigers. I
Yeah,
don't
it's
know
kind of
either.
a mess at this point. It has been for the last couple of years, and you're not getting any top caliber prospects or players back in exchange for a above average closer reliever who, and it's not like he's in a contract year. He's got 3 years, I think, of control is what I heard left.
That's what,
So that's a lot of value there. And it's not like the Tigers were like, hey, well, we can't re-sign him next year, so we're going to trade him. So not sure what they're doing, but I don't know anyway, so.
I mean that really surprised me too on the Tigers end, because the Tigers have they don't have many all-star players, like, at all. I mean, Miggy's on his way out, and then you have Javi Baez, who, I'm sorry, but that contract looks terrible. Erod, who they signed to that massive deal last season, and he's like nowhere to be found.
Yeah, I know.
And then they're just they're in the future's not looking too good, at least for the next couple of years. So if you have a guy like Gregory Soto, and you want to try to command as much that you can get out of the Phillies in that trade. And I feel like they really undervalued him in this trade. And like I said, I definitely think the Phillies are the clear-cut winners. But you know, I mean, I thought for sure the Phillies would have to give up more.
Yeah, I was shocked when I saw the trade details come out that Phillies gave up Vierling. Like I said, good player, but not great player. And I don't
He's
think the
solid, is what he
potential,
is.
yeah, I don't think the potential is really high. But the floor, I don't know. The floor is, it's not awful, but he's
No,
like
it's
you said,
not.
he's a solid player. So I don't know. The Tigers somewhat, they kind of frustrate me, but a lot of franchises do the way they handle things. They're not
That is
quite at the
true.
top of the list. They're just not in a good spot.
No.
Torkelson didn't have a good year last year when he came up, and Matt, the pitcher there, pitching prospect. I can't remember his name now.
Yeah, me neither. I mean, and Casey Mize, I mean,
Casey Mize, that's who I'm thinking
is
of.
that who it is? Okay.
I don't know why I said Matt. Sorry.
I mean, Casey Mize is solid, but I mean, I remember a couple years ago, there was so much hype around him. I mean,
Yeah.
MLB The Show, his card was unstoppable. It was great. But yeah, I mean, Detroit, best of luck to you. That's it.
Yeah. Sorry, City. I mean, your football team's getting a little bit better. I mean, that's something to
Which
look
that
forward to.
I'm happy for that. I'm happy for you guys
Yeah.
for that.
Yeah. We'll move on. A few more minor signings here. I think we'll stay in my division for a little bit. Gene Segura moved on down to Miami from the Phillies. We will miss you, Gene. Put in some good time in Philly. We got you to your first playoff appearance, and we went the whole way to the World Series. You had some fantastic plays in the postseason. I'm sorry your time ended, though. Trey Turner kind of pushed you out the door, and Bryson Stott. I'm guessing Stott's scooting over to second. So there wasn't necessarily a spot. He's too good to be a bench player. And that's kind of what the Phillies had to offer him. I don't know that they were really considered options to sign him back, because there just wasn't a spot for him. But 2 years, $17 million down in Miami, good pickup for the Marlins. Gene's an underrated player.
I love this fit. And as you said, the Phillies took him to his first playoff appearance, probably his last, if I had to guess, if he's spending the rest of his career in Miami. But no, I definitely agree with you. I love Gene Segura. I truly do. And I enjoyed watching him play. And for me, if okay, so there's a lot of trade rumors going around with the Yankees trading Gleyber Torres. Don't know if that's going to come to fruition or whatever, but Gene Segura was one of the guys who I wanted the Yankees to look into, especially if they were serious about getting rid of Gleyber Torres in a trade. Gene Segura is a perfect guy who, I mean, he hits for such a high average. And as you said, he's underrated. Not a lot of people know how, like, if you don't watch him on an everyday basis, you don't know truly how good he is. And I think that veteran presence that he has, and he's so well respected in this game, taking that down to Miami and just, you know, he's going to fit so well in that clubhouse. And I think him and Jazz, that's going to be fun, man.
Oh
I'm
yeah.
really I'm excited to watch some Marlin games.
Yeah, him and Jazz. I think Gene can play shortstop, so I would imagine him being the shortstop and Jazz staying at second. That'd be my guess. But then those two turning double plays, and Gene is such a fun player. You see him
He
out
is.
there on the field or in the dugouts or on social media, anything like that. He's always having fun, laughing. So him and Jazz is gonna be a great combo. And yeah, I mean, it's good. We'll get to see him in the division still. Hopefully, it doesn't come back to bite us too much. But yeah, happy for Gene.
Me too. I think this is like a perfect transition, because of how we were saying about Gene Segura going to the Marlins. Miguel Rojas was traded today to the Dodgers. So after losing Trey Turner, guessing the Dodgers will use Miguel Rojas, barring any moves.
Yeah, I think he's not quite Gene Segura level, but he's a solid player too.
Yeah, I think you saw, and I really like this pickup for the Dodgers. The Dodgers work their magic on these players. I don't understand how they do it. But I think Miguel Rojas is going to fit in nicely. And of course they still have the, you know, I mean, they're the Dodgers, and they have the cap room now without signing Trey Turner. I don't know, go after Shohei or something like that. Probably wouldn't surprise me, but
Yeah.
Miguel Rojas was just another minor move.
And this, I think we'll wrap it up with this because this is a sort of different situation related to the Dodgers. We're going to talk about Trevor Bauer a little bit, okay? We're keeping it baseball here. I think my opinion, I'll dive right into this. Dodgers have said they're not keeping him, so they DFA'd him. They're looking to trade him if anybody's interested, but why would anybody trade for him when you can just get him on a veteran's minimum contract? So, or a league minimum contract. So I think that there's teams that are out there interested in him. I feel like I've heard the Astros, I believe, Yankees possibly as well. Is that right?
I mean, Yankees Twitter is a very toxic place. I've heard everything on there. I supposedly we were training for Tatis and Mike Trout this offseason. So, whatever. But I did hear a little bit about it, yeah.
You think Astros would be a good fit?
I mean, yes. I mean that Astros team is loaded. And if you had, you know, if Bauer can get back to what his Cy Young season was, or even half of that, I mean, it's kind of a win for the production that you're getting for the amount of money you're spending.
Yeah, for
I mean,
sure.
you add him to any staff, he makes that staff better, especially if he can get back to 2019.
Yeah, it's crazy to think that he won AL, NL, Cy Young,
NL with
NL.
the
Yeah,
Reds,
with
yeah.
the Reds. That's right. So I'm not sure what the market's like, though, in terms of teams interested. Astros is really the only one that I've heard.
Yeah.
I thought I heard Yankees. But maybe that was just Yankees, toxic Yankees Twitter, or just
Wouldn't
general.
surprise me.
The Yankees, it's kind of like the Lakers. You hear they're interested in every player that's possibly going to get traded. So the Yankees are interested in every possible free agent interested, air quotes there. So I don't know. We'll see. There's enough teams that need starting pitching. It's just, do you want the baggage that comes with it? Everything else? Are you willing to take a risk? Because obviously, if this was a player just looking at the pitcher, everybody wants a former Cy Young winner. Corey Kluber still has value in this league, and he's, I don't want to say he's washed, but he's nearing the end of his career.
Yeah.
So there's going to be teams that are going to take a chance on, but taking a chance is even like, it's an interesting phrase to say because the last time he pitched, he was still pitching at a pretty good level.
Yeah, I mean that if you look at that contract that the Dodgers signed him to, I mean he was a pretty good pitcher. The numbers he was putting up were extremely solid. Borderline elite. I mean, this guy was going out and giving you 6, 7 innings of no hit. I'm sorry. No run baseball, one run baseball. Exactly what you want out of a starting pitcher. It's just as you said, do you want the baggage that comes with it? Because that's
Yeah.
exactly what whichever team is going to take a flyer on him is most likely going to get. But at the same time, is it truly taking a chance? Because you're going to be paying this guy league minimum. I mean, IKF is making more money than that. That's ridiculous. I mean, that's just what happens, you know. But yeah, I mean, whoever gets him, it's going to be a storyline.
And I guess there's a chance that there would be a chance that he doesn't even sign, I would say. Either a combination of teams not interested and combination of maybe he doesn't want to sign with either certain teams or for that little bit, because clearly he's shown that he has other things that he's fine with doing with Eric Sim and making all this content. So literally he's doing all right outside of baseball. Pitching wise outside of baseball, I think he's doing all right. So I think there's a possibility he doesn't necessarily sign or waits till nearer the postseason if he's able to stay fresh and then wait to sign. So
That very well could be the outcome that happens. I guess to just wrap this up really quickly, just to name off a few of the other signings, Brandon Belt, Johnny Cueto, Nelson Cruz, AJ Pollock, Eric Hosmer, Evan Longoria, Corey Kluber, as you mentioned, Nate Eovaldi, Dalton Varsho, and Michael Conforto were all of the minor signings that happened.
Off the market, Dalton Varsho trade.
Trade. Yes,
Yeah,
trade.
I like that move for the Blue Jays.
I do too. Well, not being a Yankee fan, but I thought at first that they gave up a little too much, but the Blue Jays always seem to be up there. Good move for him. I mean, Dalton Varsho was a guy who I wanted the Yankees to trade for. We still have an outfielder spot open that we need. So yeah.
Yeah.
I really like the move for both sides. The Diamondbacks got one of the top prospects in all of baseball, and they got a
Yeah.
super utility guy in Gurriel. So
Yeah,
I like it.
it was a win-win for both teams. I'd say the Diamondbacks more won the trade, but
I
overall,
agree.
both teams, Blue Jays had a surplus of catchers, and everybody knew that going into the offseason. So it was a matter of if they were interested in trading some or not. So turns out they were. You got anything else? Closing thoughts, Kyle?
I don't think so. I think that's pretty much it.
All right, yeah. We're looking forward to all kinds of off-season stuff coming up. World Baseball Classic coming up soon, and that'll be fun. Watching that and everything. Hopefully US Team USA gets that dub, but I don't know, we'll be keeping track of all the free agent stuff. We'll be back here on the podcast, more stuff coming up. Make sure you check out our Instagram and all that fun stuff. We're putting out good content every day. So, yeah, thanks for listening, watching, whatever you're doing. We'll see you next week.
Yep, super excited. See you, man.